Welcome and thank you for joining us at First United Methodist Church. We're on a mission to love better. This includes our community, ourselves, and you as we strive to embody the living Christ. Visit our website, jcfumc.org, or contact our church office to find out more about this mission and how you play a part. Thank you for worshiping with us today.
And would you mind remain standing as we hear this morning's gospel reading? Brought to us by Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, verses 28 through 40. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And when he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" And they said, "The Lord needs it." And then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks along the road. And as he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to God in the highest heaven." And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." And he answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'm Karen Taylor. I'm pastor of Mission and Discipleship, and I want to add my words of welcome to those of Pastor Steve this morning. It is so good to see those of you who are in the room today. We're grateful for those of you joining on live stream who are watching on Facebook Live or watching us later on TV or through YouTube. You are a gift to us, and what a joy to be gathered together on this Palm Sunday as we enter into Holy Week. As we prepare for the message today, would you pause and pray with me? Oh God, it is good to be here as we embark on this journey this week, recalling again the sacrificial love of your Son, Jesus. And so open our hearts to receive that love anew this day. Bless the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts, that they may be acceptable in your sight. For you, O God, are a rock, you are a strength, you are a redeemer. And all God's people said, amen. Well, today does mark the beginning of Holy Week, and it is a central event in the life of the church. It is a week that is rich with meaning. It is the very foundation of our faith. This week gives us the why of Jesus' coming and our reason for being here today. And this week begins with Jesus going to Jerusalem. Jerusalem was a city that was at the heart of the Jewish people. When one spoke of Jerusalem, they were speaking of the whole nation of Israel. Jerusalem was the place of David, the great king, and of his descendants who ruled after him. Jerusalem is a place where God resided, first in the tabernacle that David had brought into the city, and then in the temple that Solomon built, and then in Jesus' day in the temple that had been restored after the exile. Jerusalem is a city of Israel's earthly kings. It is a place where God is worshiped. And Jerusalem was important in the life and ministry of Jesus. Jerusalem was a city that Jesus loved. When Jesus was 12 years old, he was there with his parents, and he told his parents that he must be in the temple. He must be about his father's business. Jerusalem is a city over which Jesus cried because of her unfaithfulness. Jesus cleansed the temple in Jerusalem for the practices that were not honoring of God. Jerusalem was a place where Jesus would be rejected as the prophets of old. It is a place where Jesus would die and would rise again. Jerusalem is a place where the Holy Spirit was given to not just reside in that physical temple in Jerusalem, but in the temple of all those who follow Jesus. Jerusalem is a city of Jesus' destiny, and Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. In Luke's gospel, the journey begins a couple miles outside of the city. And instead of walking into the city of Jerusalem as he had so many times before, he pauses and he instructs his disciples, two of them, to go and get a colt that had never been ridden. It might have seemed like an odd request to go and get a colt that had never been ridden. What would they do with that? But it alludes to Zechariah 9. Zechariah 9 says this, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem, see your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on the colt, the foal of a donkey." So Jesus entering Jerusalem on this colt fulfills the words of the prophets. Some see Jesus riding on this colt into the city as a contrast to the kings of Judah that were predicted in Genesis 49. In Genesis 49, the kings of Judah were described as binding their colts to the choice vine of others and washing their garments in wine. It was a description of the excess and indulgences of the kings, of the earthly kings. But Jesus was not that kind of king. He was one who was not indulgent. Rather, he must even borrow the colt that he rides in making his kingly entrance. And this colt had never been ridden. It was a pure animal. One was to offer the very best they had to God. You didn't offer God something secondhand. You didn't offer God something that was used. And Jesus, God's son, would ride on a colt that had not been used by another. This request that Jesus gave his disciples to make of the owner of the colt demonstrates Jesus' authority. The disciples merely had to say, "The Lord needs it," and they were given the colt. The words of Jesus on the lips of his disciples carry the same authority as Jesus saying it himself. So those disciples went and found everything as Jesus had instructed. And when they returned, they placed their cloaks on the back of that colt and set Jesus on this colt that had never been ridden. And then they were on their way again to Jerusalem. And as they made their way, the disciples began to lift their songs of praise, their joyful words of praise and adoration, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Can't you just hear the words of joy and hope and adoration in this song that they sang? In Luke's telling of this entrance into Jerusalem, we notice that it is the disciples who are singing these words of praise. Again, Luke says this, "As Jesus was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen." So you see, it wasn't a crowd gathered for a festival that are singing these songs of praise. It wasn't a crowd that had caught up in the frenzy of a parade. Rather, it was the followers of Jesus. It was Jesus' disciples. And they were singing words of praise of what they had experienced, what they had seen Jesus do. And as they prepare to enter the city, they recall these great deeds of power that Jesus had done. And their hearts begin to overflow with praise and adoration. And they could do nothing less than give voice to their praise as they said, Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. When pilgrims to Jerusalem entered the city for festivals, they would say traditional words from Psalm 118. Psalm 118 says, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." The disciples, however, in their praise of Jesus, make one significant change in those words. Instead of saying, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord," they say, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." They seem to know somehow that this is a different kind of entry into Jerusalem, that there is something different about Jesus. Jesus is recognized as King, as one who is worthy to devote their lives to. And even though they may not fully grasp it just yet, they are acknowledging that Jesus is a different kind of King. Because the next words in their song didn't come from the Psalms, those next words reflect the song of the angels when Jesus was born. The next phrase of that song says, "Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Jesus' rule is to be one of peace, one that reaches all the way to heaven, one that restores what is broken, one that restores what is lost. It is a rule of peace, a peace that no earthly king could achieve or maintain. The Pax Roma of that day, the peace that Rome brought, was one of military oppression. But the peace that Jesus as King brings would be a peace of the heart, peace made with God. So Jesus' entry into Jerusalem is not one as a political ruler. He didn't come to rip the power from Rome, even though he could. He came to rule in the hearts and the lives of people. So in Luke's gospel, you may have noticed there's no waving of the palm branches. The palm branches were for parades, for monarchs. It is for political parades. And Luke is painting a picture of a different kind of king than a political ruler, because Jesus' kingdom, again, is not limited to Jerusalem. Rather, his rule was for the whole world, for all humanity, a rule that reached all the way to heaven and was for all time. As Jesus and the disciples make their way into Jerusalem, the Pharisees enter the story. And unlike the disciples who cannot help but praise Jesus as they walk along, the Pharisees say to Jesus, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop. Order your disciples to stop." We're not told why the Pharisees made this demand of Jesus. Maybe it was they were worried about Jesus' safety. We're not sure. They had warned Jesus that Herod was wanting to kill Jesus, and this parade was drawing attention to Jesus, and it could be dangerous for him. Maybe they were afraid that this display would disturb the fragile peace held with Rome. Calling Jesus a king could be perceived as a threat, one that Rome would not tolerate. And this disturbance would threaten the fragile power that the Pharisees held in the city as well. Maybe the Pharisees make this demand because they see a threat to their religious power. Their songs of praise of the disciples messed with their theology, and it was uncomfortable for them. Whatever the reason, the Pharisees are asking Jesus to have his followers stop their songs of praise. And how does Jesus respond? Jesus says, "I tell you, if these were silent, if these disciples were silent, the very stones would shout out." Jesus knew this was no ordinary moment. This was no casual moment in Jesus' life. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. He's on his way to Jerusalem to fulfill his purpose for coming, to fulfill his destiny. And this entry into Jerusalem begins the culmination of Jesus' life and ministry. And it was right for his disciples to sing these words of gratitude and praise, these words of worship of Jesus. And in fact, Jesus said, if these followers of mine were silent right now, the stones would shout out. You see, Jesus is also the Lord of creation. John's gospel tells us that Jesus, the Word, was present when the world was formed. Jesus is the one that holds all creation together, John tells us. And it's a reminder that Jesus' ministry isn't just for people, but he came for creation as well. We recall in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve's sin impacted not just humans, but it impacted the created world as well. And Jesus' coming is setting free creation from the brokenness as well. And creation itself cannot help but respond to Jesus' presence. We see when Jesus was born, a star declared his birth. Jesus stilled the storms, the wind and the waves obeyed his voice. When Jesus hung on the cross, the sun went dark. When Jesus died, stones split apart. When Jesus rose from the dead, the very ground shook with victory. All creation recognizes Jesus' authority. Jesus is worthy of praise. And if his followers do not speak those words of praise, the very rocks will do so. Today we begin our journey to Jerusalem. So how will we enter this week? How will we make that journey? It is a week for us to recall the life and ministry of Jesus, to recall who Jesus is and what Jesus has done for us. But not just those stories in the Bible, but it is those stories. But what has Jesus done that has impacted our lives? What has Jesus done for us personally? We as disciples walk with Jesus to Jerusalem, and we should be sharing words of gratitude and praise and worship because we have received grace in our lives. We have been given much for which to give praise and thanks. And so as we enter this week, are we willing to offer our own words of praise and gratitude for who Jesus is and what Jesus has done for us? Or do we let others silence our voice? Do we listen to the voices that say we should not speak words of faith? That it is dangerous to share those stories, that it might make people uncomfortable, that if we share our words of faith, that it might offend? Do we let others silence our voices because we fear what others might think? And we may think our story is not important or our story is not complete and not worthy of sharing. Do we find our voices silent because we have not been willing to see who Jesus is and we have not experienced that grace that Jesus offers? Do we find our voices still because we expected something from Jesus that he didn't give us? Because we were thinking one path and Jesus' path for us was a different one. And we were disappointed. Do we find our voices silent because this week reminds us that we do need a king who alone can give us the peace that we long for? Yet submitting to that king seems like too big of a price. Or instead, can we find ourselves like the disciples? Can we lift our voices because we have experienced that amazing grace in our lives? Do we lift our voices because we know we have been included, even though we fall short in so many ways? We are included as God's sons and daughters, as God's beloved children, because Jesus loves us. Do we lift our voices in praise because we have experienced forgiveness, because we have experienced a love that is beyond words, a love that is freely, sacrificially given to us? And because we have received that love, we cannot help but sing our words of praise. This week, Jesus fulfills his destiny. And this week, we encounter our destiny as well. And it can be a challenging journey because this journey can expose the dark places in our lives. But they're exposed so that we can be healed and so that we can be made whole. Because Jesus' destiny is one of love. John 3:16-17 says this: "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." That is the destination of this week. Today we begin the journey with Jesus to Jerusalem. How will you enter this week? Would you pray with me? Oh God, as we pause for just a few moments, as we are on the brink of this most holy week, we pause and ask that you would open our hearts that we might receive your love anew. As we journey through this week and are reminded of the sacrificial love of Jesus, may our hearts overflow with gratitude, with humility, and with love. And as we receive all of those gifts, may our hearts overflow with words of praise so that all the world will know of your love for them. Be with us as we journey through this week, because we can't do this week alone. It's only by your grace. And so we enter this week with Jesus. And all the people said, Amen.